The 80s turned out to be a rough time for Pink Floyd, but unlike other prog rock bands, it wasn't because of the quality of their music. In 1983, the band released The Final Cut, a concept album about war and betrayal which would end up being the last to feature bassist and songwriter Roger Waters, who by this point had taken complete control of the band. His position of power evolved over the last few years, starting as the main songwriter before becoming an egotistical visionary who threw band members out on ultimatums and got into fights with film directors. The remaining members of Floyd, including Waters, were by no means happy with the situation, and the album's tumultuous creation didn't help. Following some solo albums, Waters attempted to stop the Pink Floyd name entirely under the idea that the entire thing was creatively spent. Following this was a lengthy legal battle as the remaining members David Gilmour and Nick Mason fought tooth and nail to keep the band around. In 1987, they released A Momentary Lapse of Reason to commercial success, with its accompanying tour also doing well. Tensions were high, insults were thrown, but at the end of the year they reached a conclusion. While Waters took some things such as The Wall and The Flying Pig, Pink Floyd was allowed to go on. There was a clear, decisive winner by the end. And so Floyd continued to tour all the way up to 1990 and even released a live album called The Delicate Sound of Thunder in 1988. With much of the drama of the past decade out of the way, the band was allowed to relax a bit. Now in control of Pink Floyd, they were free to do what they wanted. A follow-up to A Momentary Lapse of Reason began at Britannia Row Studios in early 1993 with David Gilmour, Nick Mason, Richard Wright, now back as an official member of the band, and Guy Pratt, bassist from the previous tour. They later moved to Gilmour's houseboat recording studio, the Astoria, alongside producer Bob Ezrin and engineer Andy Jackson, and continued to hammer out the songs. The sound they had honed in on was distinctly modern. Alternative rock was the big thing at the time, but a lot of influence seemed to be taken from the ambient and new age scenes that were developing. At a time when rock was dominated by bands like Oasis and Blur, Floyd took influence from groups like The Orb, who themselves were heavily influenced by Floyd. At one point, Pink Floyd had even considered releasing an ambient album called The Big Spliff, though this never happened. Blending these meditative new sounds with Pink Floyd's expected bombastic prog rock, the results were unique. No album before or after this one strikes the same tone. There were other changes to the creative process outside of this new influence, however. The band were in a tricky spot without Waters. While Gilmour could write, he often brought in other people to work alongside him, such as on A Momentary Lapse of Reason, where half of the songs have at least one co-writer. At the time, Gilmour was dating journalist Polly Sampson. She initially gave him sparks of inspiration, but this ended up becoming a full co-writer position, and the result of this collaboration were a bunch of songs of elegant prose that all worked together to make a coherent whole. The Division Bell. While not apparent at first glance, The Division Bell is actually a pseudo-concept album about the topic of communication. While all of the songs work on their own, they all fit together nicely under a unified idea, but it requires you to make sense of the connecting ties. Gilmour described it as a non-immediate album, one that requires time and reflection to actually understand, and I fully agree with that statement. It's something Floyd, though especially the Waters-led era, doesn't really do. The reason why The Division Bell might work this way is largely because it wasn't written as a concept album. There is an enormous amount of stuff about communication or lack of communication on the whole album, but that's accidental. We started finding that there were one or two songs like that, and other songs emerged that had it within them. It seemed to take over the album at some point and dominate the thinking. The concept naturally leads to a lot of theories about the band's history, especially after the large public controversy of the Roger Waters lawsuit, though the band has always stressed that it's not an album about their split. In reality, the record has a complicated relationship with the band that made it, sometimes hinting at or flat out talking about figures of their past, while keeping it vague enough that it could mean a lot of things. In interviews, Gilmour shot down theories about songs like Poles Apart, High Hopes, and A Great Day for Freedom, saying that they aren't pieces about Pink Floyd. There is some room for interpretation, and some songs have been exposed for being about something more personal, but Gilmour didn't want the album to be known for its drama. I don't like to get too specific about lyrics. It places limitations on them and spoils the listener's interpretation. But even the lineup seems to reflect on the band's history. Outside of Wright's return, the band was composed mainly of those who played with the band for a momentary lapse of reason. Harkening back to the late 70s and early 80s, however, Michael Kamen and Bob Ezrin would return to the process, marking Kamen's first appearance since the Final Cut and Ezrin's first since a momentary lapse. Saxophonist Dick Perry also returned to the band after his appearance on Wish You Were Here in 1975. In a way, this lineup of Pink Floyd was the culmination of their career and the different eras of it. A composer who worked within the band's most hostile environment ran by their former visionary. A band put together after that visionary left who found success on their own. In an obscure way, the Division Bell's music is its own statement. The album's messaging seeped into one of their most iconic covers, depicting two metal heads in a field in Cambridgeshire. Designed by Storm Thorgerson, the idea was to get at the album's central concept of communication through an illusion. While there are two distinct faces on the cover, there's also a hidden third in the empty spaces between the two. Different variants of the cover were shot and used for different releases, showing the faces in different forms and at different times of day. There's also objects between the mouths, such as lights and red flags. They create a dotted trail between the faces, portraying a discussion between the two beings. Other designs emphasize symmetry, much like the heads do, showing a balance within these discussions and relations. All of it comes together to create a visual style that doesn't just embody the concept, but actively demonstrates it to the audience. That said, the concept doesn't even stop at the art. While the band was on tour for the Division Bell, the mysterious Publius Enigma game started. In Usenet groups, an anonymous user going by the name Publius hinted at a hidden meaning within the Division Bell that fans must uncover. While initially greeted with skepticism, it was made clear that the user was an official part of the band's tour. As of writing, this mystery has still not been solved, and it looks likely that it never will, though many fans have dedicated themselves to the case. Some have even claimed that they found the answer, though the answers given are mostly incoherent. Ultimately, there was a lot going for the Division Bell. That said, at the time of its release, it wasn't met with great reviews. In Tom Graves' write-up for Rolling Stone, he wrote, "The Division Bell is a quieter, more atmospheric and contemplative Pink Floyd, with lyrics so opaque and inert, one cannot hope to plumb their meaning." The album also gives off the uncomfortable whiff of middle age and graying sensibilities. Gilmour, who has become Pink Floyd's de facto leader, in particular seems bored or dispirited. His guitar solos were once the band's centerpieces, as articulate, melodic, and well-defined as any in rock. No longer. He now has settled into rambling, indistinct asides that are as forgettable as they used to be indelible. On top of the conflicted response was that central question that followed Pink Floyd since Waters' departure. Is this even Pink Floyd? Without the lyricist who brought so many landmark concepts to life, the lineup may only seem like Floyd in name alone. Even Waters himself publicly criticized the album, saying, "It's just nonsense from beginning to end." Even 30 years later, there's still a sense of conflict around this album. People debate whether this is canon or not, or if it was even good to begin with. I find this to be tragic, however, because even though I'm a huge fan of the Waters era, the Division Bell has a surprising amount of depth. The history, meaning, and of course its musical sensibilities contain so many great and interesting things to talk about and experience. I return to it a ton. I'd place it as one of my favorites in the band's discography. I think it holds up with classics like Wish You Were Here and The Wall. It's honestly a good record. The Gilmour era of Pink Floyd is seen as a divisive hit-and-miss window for the band, and there is truth to that. A Momentary Lapse of Reason and The Endless River, let alone singles like Hey Hey Rise Up, are no doubt controversial for a myriad of reasons. However, if anything showed that this moment of time could truly lead to incredible heights, it was the Division Bell in all of its intricate glory. We could argue day through night about whether this is actually a Floyd album, but there really is no debate. The album has the name right on the cover. And guess what? The music on it is fitting of its name. So let's interpret this album. Let's talk about it, and let's dive into the many ways that it still communicates to this day. Opening the Division Bell is an instrumental called Cluster 1, and it's one of two instrumentals on the album. For a record about communication, that might seem odd. However, both songs reinforce the concept in their own way. In fact, Cluster 1 evokes the themes immediately. It starts with the static clicking sounds of a dawn chorus, an electromagnetic phenomenon that happens around sunrise. The sound itself is picked up on radio equipment and seems to imitate birds chirping. That's where it gets thematic. A dawn chorus is an imitation of communication. It's a false recording of bird songs, a false recording of discussion. It could also be seen more abstractly as communication between the Earth and the Sun, as it is made up of signals from that star. It's kind of a small thing in the grand scheme of the division bell, but it sets up the tone perfectly. The composition that follows the minute-long introduction also reinforces the themes of the album. Wright and Gilmour trade riffs and melodies between each other before Nick Mason comes in and lays a steady rhythm. The band is communicating between each other through music here, going from one to the other and back again to create a calm, relaxed piece. It's a very simple idea that lays at the foundation of music itself. Without communication, there is no unity. You might wonder what the title of the track actually means, and surprisingly, it doesn't really have one. Andy Jackson recalled that the track was given its title due to in-studio naming schemes. When Floyd jammed, they divided the tracks into different tones, and when they combined those tones, they called them a cluster. This is Cluster 1. While the instrumentals are not the most complex tracks on the album, it's hard to say they don't help the album move forward. They're gorgeous to listen to with a good pair of headphones, but they also help convey the band's exploration of life through speech. As an opener, Cluster 1 does exactly what it needs to. It sets the stage and gets us ready for more, and the rest of the album does provide that fill. What Do You Want From Me is one of the biggest songs from the album, but also one that has been misinterpreted through time. The song has long been seen as a pointed question to the band's audience, and there's some good precedent to believe so. The lyrics play around with the imagery of concerts, the lights dimming, Gilmour playing, it's all very theatrical. On top of that, a sense of isolation and alienation from Pink Floyd's fans has long been a part of the band's history. It's even been a focal point of some of their albums. However, that's not what Gilmour and Sampson were trying to discuss with this song. When asked if this was about a sense of alienation between artist and audience, as previously covered on The Wall, Gilmour stated, "It didn't start out from there at all. It actually had more to do with personal relationships, but drifted into wider territory. No, I don't really feel a great sense of alienation from the audience. I never agreed with Roger on his dramatic treatise in the lyrics of The Wall, but it was a very good idea. I've been doing it for a long time, I've become wealthy from it and sort of revered. All the things that create a gulf between you and your audience. Given that, I feel we have great communication with people who come to see us, and I enjoy performing for them." If the song's not specifically about the audience, however, who is it about? Well, as previously mentioned by Gilmour, the song came out of his relationship with Pauly Sampson. He said to Guitar World in 1994, "Some of the lyrics actually came out of our relationship, and some, unfortunately, came after moments of lack of communication between us. For example, the title What Do You Want From Me came out of exactly one of those moments." The lyrics are combative, with Gilmour questioning an unnamed other person, asking them directly what they want. He sees that person as demanding and controlling, wanting more from someone than they can reasonably give. That's really as simple as this gets. It's a fraught interaction between people stuck at a crossroads. It's intentionally vague. While this may come off as shallow, I think it ultimately works as the first lyrical song on the album. Again, we're still introducing the concept of communication, and What Do You Want From Me is so open-ended that the idea comes across instantly. I'd even argue the power of the song comes from the universality of it. We've all been in situations where someone is truly hard to please, and the song understands the frustration of such an interaction. It's snarling and cynical in its word choice. It's someone who's just had enough. Outside of this simplicity, there are a few things that I think are worth bringing up. For instance, this song has the phrase "daisy chains" in it, first heard all the way back on Dark Side of the Moon's Brain Damage. I'm not sure if this was meant to be a callback, but the division bell is filled with these little connections and references. The album might be signaling that connection very early here. Of course, we could theoretically tie this whole song to a certain past band member, but it's really hard to say for certain. Second, the composition itself is fantastic. The song is groovy in every sense of the word, with great feel from Nick Mason and Guy Pratt, as well as some hard-hitting organ from Richard Wright. The infectious funk groove is, debatably, something Pink Floyd hasn't done since the 70s, so it's interesting to hear it come back in full force like this. Pair this with the lyrics in a live show, and you really have a standout moment on the album. Again, it's simple, but sometimes simple is all you really need, and What Do You Want From Me hits just right. If you're looking for something more poetic and deep, however, don't worry, we're about to get into that territory. The meaning of Pulls Apart seems to be a bit of a sore spot for Gilmour, and understandably so. Its three verses are pretty explicit in meaning, even though they're highly illusionary. Samson confirmed that verse one is about former frontman Syd Barrett, while the second is about Roger Waters. Gilmour, however, has been much more vague. In that same interview, when asked about the lyrics of the first verse and who they're about, he responded, "Who knows? I like to let the lyrics speak for themselves." In another interview, he said of the second verse, "People can invent and relate to a song in their personal ways, but it's a little late at this point for us to be conjuring Roger up." A quote that is no doubt ironic in retrospect. Pink Floyd is defined by certain figures with distinct reputations that lead different eras of the band, potentially more than any other act in rock history, and Pulls Apart plays with that, if not outright setting those personalities in stone. Let's look at the first verse, for example. Did you know it was all going to go so wrong? And did you see it was all going to be so right for me? The first verse details Syd Barrett, described as the golden boy with light in his eyes. It obviously conjures up the image of Barrett in the early days of around 1965-67. However, it's a bittersweet recognition, as the troubles he faced weigh on Gilmour, a man who essentially replaced him in his own band. He asks if, when the band started, he could see the unfortunate future ahead of him and the massive success Pink Floyd would go on to have without him. There's guilt and tragedy to this verse. It's someone who isn't here anymore. Hey you, did you ever realize what you'd become? Indeed. That it wasn't only me you were running from. The second verse is centered on Roger Waters, and instead of focusing on a mythologized loss, the lyrics are openly bitter. Starting with a quick reference to the song Hey You, Gilmour wonders if he understood the situation. Did Waters know the press and controversy that would surround him for his actions? On top of that, did he realize the extent of the breakup? Gilmour sings that it wasn't only him that he was running from, and while this could refer to the band as in the lineup, it could also mean something bigger. Waters was removing himself from this significant artistic force that millions of people fell in love with. He was running away not just from the band, but from his own legacy. This verse is about somebody falling into oblivion, believing they're not hurting themselves when all they have left are blind followers. Following these two verses, we get a surreal scene with circus music, a baby crying, and a tolling bell, all of which seems symbolic of the chaos that surrounded the band due to their wildly different ambitions. Perhaps the baby is one of them not getting their way, while the tolling bell is a signal of the end. It's a unique moment in the song, no doubt, but it's not where it ends. Coming out of this is the final verse, the one without confirmation. In it, Gilmour sings about metaphorical rain falling on rooftops while he was thinking of someone, that someone removing their sadness and pain. There's been some speculation as to who this verse relates to, maybe Barrett or Waters again, or even Ginger Gilmour. I'd argue he's singing about Samson here, but ultimately this third verse is larger than a guessing game. Whoever this person is, they allow Gilmour to free himself. He can move past history and expectation and forge a new path forward. In effect, Gilmour places himself in the third verse, and the end result is a powerful moment. The phrase "pulls apart" means to have nothing in common. Both Barrett and Waters are poles apart for a number of reasons, from artistic to ideological, but the same can be said for Gilmore. Pink Floyd, as a creative entity, was run by three completely different people with different aspirations, and those aspirations clash with each other in various ways. Sid was never built to be a rock star and had a number of issues that ultimately led him to abandon that world entirely. He went from bright optimism to brooding darkness. Roger was this incredible songwriter with visions about life and society who ultimately crumbled under the weight of his own self-imposed importance. David was this masterful guitar player who didn't tell stories through lyrics but through guitar notes. These are generalizations, but you can tell that there's a difference in intent. These three poles were bound to disagree. However, at this point, that's in the past. Remember, the Roger drama at this point was at least 5 years old. And so, we do move forward. We accept that the past is far gone and allow ourselves to float unrestricted, helped greatly by an incredible solo at the song's end. While we'll talk about Pink Floyd's history again in relation to this album, Poles Apart is a stunning, reflective, and definitive message about what Pink Floyd was and is. It is an autobiographical work that says bluntly how Gilmore sees the former bandleaders and what their legacies are. They range from tragic to frustrated, but there's that grain of reality to it. That these three poles, these three personalities, they sit alone but never disconnected. The final instrumental on the Division Bell is the Grammy Award-winning Marooned. It's a soft, improvised, ambient track, which calls back to albums like Metal that focuses on a long solo by David Gilmour. It might be easy to write it off as merely a great instrumental, which of course it is, but I think that its placement on the album is fitting and conceptually apt. To be marooned is to be stranded somewhere alone. You're a castaway on some island, for example. The song brings that imagery to mind, with Gilmore returning to the feedbacking seagull-like guitar shrieks of echoes throughout, but this is an album about communication. If you're stuck on an island day after day, there's nobody around, nobody to talk to or gain information from. It's as close to a vacuum as you can get, and your only way out is to communicate, to send signals to any passerbys in hopes of establishing some contact. Maybe a plane will fly over, or a boat will recognize your waving arms on the small beach, or maybe the only communication you hear will be from the seagulls overhead. There's not much to say, but also everything to say. This idea of being stranded and alone was maybe reflected in its early title as well. Andy Jackson said the track had a few names, such as The Whale Piece and Maroon, but one that stands out is Cosmic 13, which the book Pink Floyd All the Songs posits may be a reference to the Apollo 13 spaceflight, a mission that almost fell apart entirely after an explosion on the ship. The instrumental conjures images of distance, whether on an island or in the cold vacuum of space, but it also brings to mind how our desire to speak and talk is severed by those spaces. Communication is powerful, but it's only powerful when there's someone or something to reciprocate the message. If it falls on deaf ears, or the void, then it's communication in vain. Despite the ways we can conceptualize Maroon's place on the Division Bell, Gilmore shrugged it off by saying, "There's no particular huge significance to Marooned. It's just an appropriate title." But sometimes an appropriate title is all you need to get your mind racing, and this song is a great example of that. In later years, the song was given a music video for the 20th anniversary of the album, and it even made its way onto the band's compilation Echoes. Despite being an instrumental highlight of the Division Bell, Marooned has only been played a handful of times by both Pink Floyd and David Gilmour. The band played it twice in Oslo, Norway in the summer of 94, and Gilmour would play it once in 04 during a Fender charity show. It's a great moment on the album that really highlights Gilmour's guitar talent, and dare I say it's the last great Pink Floyd instrumental. Marooned embodies so much of Pink Floyd's style and approach to songwriting. Its atmosphere and feel are so visceral that you can't help but get transported out to sea. The song even has Pink Floyd's experimentation in mind, using the then-new Digitech whammy pedal to shift octaves and create unique sounds. While there have been other instrumentals past 1994, none of them hold a candle to this piece. It's no wonder that this won a Grammy.
So, an extraordinary night of euphoria in Berlin. Within hours of East Germany's decision to let its people go by opening the border to the west, the city erupted in a frenzy of celebration. East German border guards watched as jubilant crowds danced on the infamous Berlin Wall that's divided Europe for a generation.
Some started to climb over the fence itself, others found another way through it.
Playing a little with the fence!
Did you ever expect to do this?
No, never.
Well, what do you think of tonight?
It's wonderful. It's what we waited for.
And then they forced open another gate and piled through it.
In November of 1989, the Berlin Wall fell. This barrier dividing East and West Germany, which blocked East Germans from fleeing to the other side, was now gone. It had been 28 years since the first parts were constructed, and now that barrier was no more. Friends and family could finally meet once again. The Cold War, which had simmered for so many years, was finally drawing to a close. It's no wonder why people were ecstatic. Totalitarian East Germany had finally been shown the door. However, despite the optimism, things didn't shake out the way people wanted it to.
Some 2,000 people were unaccounted for. Nobody knows how many of them were executed on the spot, or how many were sent to concentration camps, where the murder continued. The rest were expelled. 49,000 Muslims lived in Sfornik. None remain. 5 centuries of Islamic life and culture there were erased. This is ethnic cleansing.
Only 3 years after the fall of the Berlin Wall, and as the USSR was crumbling, Yugoslavia was breaking apart in East Europe. Its countries were declaring and fighting for independence as nationalism began to grip the population, and as that nationalism grew, plans for expansion were drawn, and the Bosnian War began. As part of that war, Serbia conducted ethnic cleansing and genocide in Bosnia. In 3 years, they killed 100,000 people. I'm simplifying a large conflict for time here, but not even 5 years after the optimism of the end of the Cold War, tensions were already back in Europe, and the result was tragic. This left David Gilmour feeling fatalistic. Well, it's kind of tragic what has happened to the eastern parts of Europe. There was a wonderful moment of optimism when the wall came down. The release of Eastern Europe from the non-democratic side of the socialist system. But what they have now doesn't seem to be much better. Again, I'm fairly pessimistic about it all. I sort of wish and live in hope, but tend to think that history moves at a much slower pace than we think it does. I feel that real change takes a long, long time. We see the superficial changes that people think are enormous, but they pass, and several years down the road, you find yourself looking back at the same place you were 20 years before, thinking, my God, all of this happened and nothing happened. Gilmour elaborated to The Sun in 2008. First, it was a joy and a release for the people with the freedom of democracy, but then it became horribly marred by the ethnic cleansing and genocide, particularly in Yugoslavia. That pessimism is the foundation of A Great Day for Freedom. The lyrics document the destruction of the Berlin Wall and its enormous ramifications for the world at large. There are celebrations where people raise their glasses to a bright, free future with the people they used to know. This was a future which was locked away because of the wall. It was truly a great day for freedom, but the first chorus adds some melancholy. It describes a dream of someone's partner leaving despite their love because there's nothing that the narrator can do to really help them. The second verse continues that shift in mood. Democracy is here, but the honeymoon period is over. The fall brings about freedom, but also new war and suffering on an ever-changing stage. The friendliness between people that was once shared in 1989 has evaporated into cold distance and isolation. One day they will regret this hostility, but there's no going back. The final chorus, however, adds a touch of hope. The narrator wakes up to the sounds of drums, protest, and revolution in the air, but they look to their side just like they did before and see their lover. The first chorus is just a nightmare. There's still love and compassion in the world despite the grim state of politics. The central concept of the division bell appears constantly in A Great Day for Freedom. The Berlin Wall itself is a blockade on communication, a literal barrier between people that was destroyed to create a unified future built on our ability to talk and care for one another. Yet even with all of that hope, the ties between people went sour, and it ended in genocide. Wrapped up in this story is a tale about love and purpose, someone doubting their worth but realizing that the relationship they've built is still strong. In the end, communication both saves and destroys in A Great Day for Freedom. Some have even argued that this song is about Roger Waters and the fallout from his legal battle, but Gilmour has denied this, saying, A Great Day for Freedom, for example, has got nothing to do with Roger or his wall. It just doesn't. What else can I say? In the years following the song's release, A Great Day for Freedom has reappeared, most notably in 2022 when it appeared as the B-side for Hey Hey Rise Up, a charity single supporting Ukraine in the Russo-Ukrainian War, fitting for two countries with their own histories of division. A Great Day for Freedom is an emotional piece of political writing. While the politics of Floyd are often associated with Waters' time in the band, Gilmour and Sampson showed that they could write their own piece of memorable commentary with this song. It ultimately serves as a unique document of the late 80s and early 90s. It's a song that has a sense of conflict to it. On one hand, that title is heartfelt and sincere. On the other hand, it's an ominous and cynical caption to half a decade of violence. Richard Wright had to put up with a lot up to this point. In 1979, he was kicked out of the band during the sessions for The Wall over his inability to contribute to the process. He was then hired back in as a session musician for The Wall's tour due to his contract, and ironically, he was the only one that got paid. He wouldn't appear on the final cut, but would come back on a momentary lapse of reason once again as a session musician, reappearing as an official member with the release of this album. That said, Wright was never the star of Pink Floyd. He didn't have the grand concepts of Waters, nor did he have the flashy solos of Gilmour. He was a modest man on keys who laid the foundation for the band's greatest material. That said, he has sung a few songs within the Pink Floyd canon, but they really are few and far between. By 1994, the last song he sang lead vocals on was Stay from 1972, an incredibly underrated song from an underrated album. That was 22 years ago by the time of the Division Bell. With him officially becoming a member once again, it only makes sense to let him take the reins for a bit, and so we get Wearing the Inside Out, a smooth and jazzy song that was co-written by Anthony Moore of the experimental band Slap Happy and Henry Cow. This wasn't Moore's first time working with Floyd, as he had worked on A Momentary Lapse of Reason, but it's certainly the most unique contribution of his time with the band. While initially titled Evrika, taking its name from Wright's own sailing yacht, the song is pretty personal in its own lyrics. The first verse sets the stage well, someone ashamed of what they've become hiding from the people around them. That short verse is followed by the first chorus, where the protagonist says that you'll never hear a word from them again and that they, or rather who they were, is dying. Wright's words are made stronger by the backing vocalists, who give a great description of the character's state. He's curled into the corner, but still the screen is flickering with an endless stream of garbage to curse the place. In a sea of random images, the self-destructing animal waiting for the waves to break. Verse 2 shows the fading persona get worse, so much so that they can no longer hear themselves when they talk or view themselves in light. They are overpowered by the new them. The bridge, however, makes it clear they are slowly coming back, and the rest of the song is that comeback. Verse 3 recognizes the lifelessness, but sees a glimmer as they slowly start to speak again, helped by the people around them giving them the time and resources to speak. Verse 4 shows that their regained communication is a newfound strength. The final chorus doesn't give a full conclusion, but it does say this. Despite this character's redevelopment, they aren't completely there yet, but they're ready for the day that they can speak freely once again. The cloudy days of before are now leaving, and finally, they can hear people talk again. The backing vocalists give important context once again, describing the death of the bitter person the protagonist had become. He's standing on the threshold, caught in fiery anger and hurled into the furnace, he'll curse the place. He's torn in all directions, and still the screen is flickering, waiting for the flames to break. Now, what does this all get at? Pink Floyd fans might find some imagery here recognizable, as it's similar to Pink's state on the wall. This connection is only made more potent by some shared language, using the phrase bleeding hearts, first heard on The Trial and Outside the Wall. Generally speaking, the song tackles that subject of isolation, but I think it goes in a different direction. While Waters' concept speaks of how we isolate ourselves and the resulting fallout of said isolation, Moore and Wright take a different approach and study the feeling of isolation itself. Let's start at the phrase wearing the inside out. To wear the inside out is to publicly show those deep, uncomfortable feelings we all have, whether it's fear or self-doubt. In the song, the lyrics characterize a depressive episode where the protagonist's own self-doubt shows on their face, makes their skin pale, and importantly, kills and replaces the personality which was once there. Death is a prominent theme in Wearing the Inside Out, and the song intentionally uses it to mark the changes in persona. The person they were before died, and in their place was a fearful, resentful shadow. In fact, that new persona is ill. Their skin is pale and cold, their heart is beating little. It's like the former self, but it's far from healthy. However, this new persona doesn't stay, as the end of the song demonstrates that this new figure is destroyed by fire. Just like we can fall into despair, we can also rid ourselves of hopelessness through communication. That's the tie here. Isolation is not solved through more isolation, but through friendship, discussion, and understanding. The protagonist is only powerful enough to speak after being given the words to speak by others. The people around them see that they're having trouble, but give them what they need to get their thoughts out there, to bypass the new persona and crawl back to life. In the end, it's a powerful message about communication and how we can change others' lives through empathy and compassion. You could certainly draw a parallel between this and Wright's own journey within the band. Once a prominent feature, he was kicked out in an ugly fashion and left to his own devices at a time where he was already struggling. However, the band brought him back when they could, and now he's here singing on a record for the first time in decades. In a way, Wright had crawled back to life. Wearing the Inside Out is a fitting song for the Division Bell, and it's a beautiful endnote to Wright's time in the band, as this would be the last song he would ever sing on a Pink Floyd album. You couldn't ask for a better send-off.